Hello everyone, this is William Armstrong here with some news from the Hacker News, or THN, number one trusted cybersecurity news platform. And I'm going to want to talk about artificial intelligence, and this time there is another ChatGPT clone called WormGPT, but notice the difference between ChatGPT, Google Bard, and WormGPT. All three have one thing in common, artificial intelligence, but WormGPT is now a new AI tool that's been forked from ChatGPT that allows cyber criminals to launch sophisticated cyber attacks. And I'm going to read it. It says here, with generative artificial intelligence AI becoming all the rage these days, it is perhaps not surprising that the technology has been repurposed by malicious actors to their own advantage, enabling avenues for accelerated cybercrime. According to findings from SlashNext, a new generative AI cybercrime tool called WormGPT has been advertised on underground forums as a way for adversaries to launch sophisticated phishing and business email compromised BEC attacks. Basically, what phishing attacks really are is just cyber criminals are pretending to be at least a CEO or pretending to be someone that they're not, and they automatically just decide to send a phishing email to a corporation or business wanting to collect login details such as username and passwords and credentials like that. That's a form of phishing attack. Things like that, creating like a fake login page where you type in your credentials and next thing you know, you're sending off your username and password to a cyber criminal that misuses it for illicit purposes. Well, this is exactly what this AI tool that has now been forked from ChatGPT to do. It says here, this tool presents itself as a black hat alternative to ChatGPT models designed specifically for malicious activities, security researcher Daniel Kelly said. Cyber criminals can use such technology to automate the creation of highly convincing fake emails personalized to the recipient, thus increasing the chance of success for the attack. The author of the software is described as the biggest enemy of the well-known ChatGPT that lets you do all sorts of illegal stuff. Note that I don't really condone using AI, ChatGPT, or Google Bard for illegal activities. I don't. It says, in the hands of a bad actor, tools like WormGPT could be a powerful weapon, especially as OpenAI, ChatGPT, and Google Bard are increasingly taking steps to combat the abuse of large language models, LLMs, to fabricate convincing phishing emails and generate malicious code. Bard's anti-abuse restrictors in the realm of cybersecurity are significantly lower compared to those of ChatGPT, Checkpoint said in a report this week. Consequently, it is much easier to generate malicious content using Bard's capabilities. Uh-oh. Earlier this February, the Israeli cybersecurity firm disclosed how cyber criminals are working around ChatGPT's restrictions by taking advantage of its API, its application programming interface, not to mention trade stolen premium accounts and selling brute force software to hack into ChatGPT accounts by using huge lists of email addresses and passwords. The fact that WormGPT operates without any ethical boundaries underscores the threat posed by generative AI, even permitting novice cyber criminals to launch attacks swiftly and at scale without having the technical wherewithal to do so. To make matters worse, threat actors are promoting jailbreaks for ChatGPT, engineering specialized prompts and inputs that are designed to manipulate the tool into generating output that could involve disclosing sensitive information, producing inappropriate content, and executing harmful code. Generative AI can create emails with impeccable grammar, making them seem legitimate and reducing the likelihood of being flagged as suspicious, Kelly said. Yikes! The use of generative AI democratizes the execution of sophisticated BEC attacks, known as business email compromise attacks. Even attackers with limited skills can use the technology to make it an accessible tool for a broader spectrum of cyber criminals. The disclosure comes as researchers from Mithril Security surgically modified an existing open-source AI model known as GPT-J6B to make it spread disinformation and upload it to a public repository like Hugging Face that could then be integrated into other applications, leading to what is called an LLM supply chain poisoning. The success of this technique, dubbed Poison GPT, banks on the prerequisite that the lobotomized model is uploaded and using a name that impersonates a known company, in this case a type of squatter version of the Eleuther AI, the company behind GPT-J. Okay, having that said, AI is being misused by cyber criminals to do bad things, such as leveraging cyber attacks and grammar, basically using it to correct grammar, making phishing emails look more convincing and real to trick unsuspecting victims into interacting with the phishing email and clicking on a link and typing in their login credentials to a fake phishing page. ChatGPT has security restrictions in it, but Google Bard doesn't yet. But Google Bard is taking the links to add in that support. It says here, Italian watchdog bans OpenAI's ChatGPT over data protection concerns. The Italian data protection watchdog, Garante per la Protezione Personale, aka Garante, sorry if I butchered that in Italian, has imposed a temporary ban of OpenAI's ChatGPT service in the country, citing data protection concerns. To that end, it has ordered the company to stop processing users' data with immediate effect, stating it intends to investigate the company over whether it was unlawfully processing such data in violation of the EU General Data Protection Regulation, GDPR laws. Note that Europe has a GDPR. America kind of has something similar to GDPR, but it's different. No information is provided to users and data subjects whose data are collected by OpenAI, the Garante noted. More importantly, there appears to be no legal basis underpinning the massive collection and processing of personal data in order to train the algorithms on which the platform relies. ChatGPT, which is estimated to have reached over 100 million monthly active users since its release late last year, has not disclosed what it used to train its latest large language model, LLM, GPT-4, how it trained it. That said, its predecessor, GPT-3, utilizes text sourced from books, Wikipedia, and Common Crawl, the latter which maintains an open repository of web crawl data that can be accessed and analyzed by anyone. The Garante also pointed to a lack of any age verification system prevent minors from accessing the service, potentially exposing to inappropriate responses. Google's own chatbot called Bard is only open to those users over the age of 18. Additionally, the regulator raised questions about the accuracy of the information surfaced by ChatGPT while also highlighting a data breach that the service suffered earlier last month that exposed some users' chat titles and payment-related information. Yikes! In response to the order, OpenAI has blocked its own generative AI chatbot from being accessed by users with an Italian IP address. It also said it's issuing refunds to subscribers of ChatGPT Plus in addition to pausing subscription renewals. The San Francisco-based company further emphasized that it provides ChatGPT in compliance with GDPR and other privacy laws. ChatGPT is already blocked in China, Iran, North Korea, and Russia. My big question is, China blocks ChatGPT as well. Iran, North Korea, and Russia, those countries block it, but North Korea has a limited internet up there, and China has a limited internet as well. So I don't see why would they do that when half their internet is limited in North Korea and China, things like that. In a statement shared with Reuters, OpenAI said it actively works to reduce personal data and training our AI systems like ChatGPT because we want our AI team to learn about the world, not about private individuals. OpenAI has 20 days to notify the Garante of the measures it has to take to bring in compliance or restriction fines up to €20 million or 4% of the total worldwide annual turnover, whichever is higher. The ban, however, is not expected to impact applications from other companies that employ OpenAI technology to augment their services, including Microsoft Bing's search engine and its co-pilot offerings. The development also comes as Europol warned that LLMs like ChatGPT are likely to help generate malicious code, facilitate fraud, and offer criminals new opportunities, especially for crimes involving social engineering, given its abilities to respond to messages in context and adopt a specific writing style. This is not the first time AI-focused companies have come under the radar. Last year, a controversial facial recognition firm Clearview AI was fined by multiple European regulators for scraping users' publicly available photos without consent to train its identity matching service. It has also ran afoul of privacy laws in Australia, Canada, and the U.S., with several countries ordering the company to delete all the data it obtained in such a manner. Clearview told the AI told the BBC News last week that it has run nearly 8 million searches for U.S. law enforcement agencies despite being permanently banned from selling its FaceCrunch database within the country. Yikes. Having that said, I wanted to automatically just say my opinion on the whole AI thing and the risks. AI has risks in it, it does, but cyber criminals are now seeing this perfect window of opportunity to take advantage of AI to launch phishing attacks, to launch all sophisticated attacks against companies. So now artificial intelligence is going to be weaponized by criminals in the future to do more cybercrime than before. Before, cyber criminals were using ransomware. They were using ransomware, spyware, adware trojans, backdoor trojans, like these remote access trojans, and also plain trojans and worms that would spread across a computer network and the internet, viruses that would attach themselves to a file and email attachment and then would attach themselves to an email and mail themselves out by going through the contacts list on email programs. Like in early 1998 to like 2003, computer viruses would scan a user's email address book on their computer and mail copies of itself to everyone in the address book, prompting further spread. And back then, computer worms would travel across the internet easily, just upload themselves to different computers on the network. In most cases, the worms would also travel all over the internet and travel on local networks too, things like that. And another thing that I have to say is now we've got to worry about ransomware attacks, phishing attacks, artificial intelligence being used to launch cyber attacks. Now that's a new concern with AI in the scene. Before AI was ever a thing, that's what people worried about in early 2000 with worms, viruses, trojans, spyware, adware, and even in dial-up days, there were small little programs called dialer programs that were malicious that would dial premium toll rate phone numbers in the background. I'll show you what that is. Hold on. Please note that this is Google Bard, so I'm going to read what generative AI is going to say. And it says generative AI is experimental. Info quality may vary. It says a dialer program is a malicious program that's installed on a computer and tries to use the dialing features to call other numbers. Dialers can be a type of spyware or Trojan horse. They can change the system's dial-up and networking settings without the user's consent or approval. Dialers can run on every computer startup and attempt to hide the presence of the system. Dialers can run up expensive phone bills for the victim by secretly connecting the computer to premium rate lines. They can also dial long-distance numbers or connect to pay-per-call sites, which can result in users being charged for the calls. Dialers are sometimes included with free software-type downloads. They can also be offered as programs for accessing adult sites. Okay, so dialer programs, or dialer, according to F-Secure, this is an older article from F-Secure here. It's a type of spyware that is a Trojan dialer. It sometimes goes underneath as adult NSFW dialer, things like that. But it says here, a program that connects the computer to the internet via a telephone line and modem. Malicious dialers will secretly connect the computer to premium rate lines. So here it is. It says the type designation dialer was previously used by F-Secure to identify a program that connects the computer to internet via telephone line and modem. Malicious dialers secretly connect the computer to premium rate lines, greatly increasing the usage charges payable by the user. Some dialers, known as NSFW dialers, also provide its users with access to an NSFW content, which may be inappropriate or unwanted. It changes in threat landscape today. Programs previously identified as dialer programs would now be classified under the riskware category with the type designation application. The update in naming better clarifies the program's overall security profile in the current significant more threatening malware environment. Note that dialer programs are no longer used in 2023 because since dial-up is completely dead, the dialer programs are long gone. Let me see if I can find a Wikipedia article. Let's see. CyberLab PC Cleaner? No. Here it is. I'll read a full Wikipedia article here a little bit. It says here, a dialer, American English, or dialer, British English, is an electronic device that's connected to a telephone line to monitor the dialed numbers. That's actually a dialer device, but another type of dialer is called a computer program, which creates connection to the internet on another computer network over the analog telephone or integrated services digital network, ISDN line. Many operating systems already contain such a program for the connections through the point-to-point protocol, PPP, such as WVDIAL. It says here, many internet service providers offer installation CDs to simplify the process of setting up a proper internet connection. They either create an intentionally the OS's dialer to install a separate dialer as the AOL software does. It says here, in the recent years, the term dialer often refers to specifically dialers that connect without the user's full knowledge as the cost with the creator of the dialer intending to commit fraud. Okay, having that said, that's an explanation about how dialers work, about computer dialers or dial-up modems of the 66K era, where non-broadband connections such as dial-up modems, like I used to use AOL 9.0 SE Optimize that included a AOL dialer program, a small little file in the background on Windows in 2003, 2004, that when I used to, when I used to connect to dial-up, I would do by launching the AOL software on Windows and hit sign on with my screen name, willcat123@aol.com. It's a long dead screen name. I've retired my screen name, which is my real screen name on AOL, but it's been retired. But I would tell it to dial with my username and password, and it would sign on me to AOL, and I would connect and be on the homepage of AOL for a long while, things like that. Note that I often played kid games, like I played like AOL kids games on dial-up back then. That's all I did. I enjoyed that as a kid. But take note that me in 2023 now, looking back at it, I realized dial-up's okay. It's just terrible back then. I'm glad it's dead now. But the only threat was that dialer programs, like little small Windows malware dialers, were malicious that could dial premium toll rate charge numbers in the background on the computer's dial-up modem, resulting in high phone bill long-distance toll charges, which could cause a phone bill to go sky high, and that would be the reason for the computer causing the phone bill to go up, because it's dialing premium toll rate numbers in the background that makes matters worse. But dialers back in early 2003 had a legitimate use. One was to dial phone numbers to like AOL to sign up for their internet dial-up service in order to connect to their network to get online. But AOL introduced a dialer program known as AOL Dialer, I do remember back then. Let me search it up and I'll show you what it looks like. This is what I used to use back in like early 2003. Right here is the AOL Dialer, an older version. It's just a miniature program that sat in the background of Windows XP, things like that. It was also available on Linux. There was also a Linux version of it, known as AOL Dialer for Linux, but that's not official by AOL. But this is what it looked like. This is the little itty-bitty program I used to use back in like 2003, 2004, that would persistently dial a background connection. What you would do is you put in your screen name, password, hit save, and you would hit sign on, and it would dial a background connection to AOL servers. And then you would be able to use Internet Explorer or other web browsers during that. Things like that. That's essentially what AOL Dialer was in early 2003. That it would just generate a background dial-up connection to AOL network. And then you could open up Internet Explorer or other web browsers and surf the net that way without having to have the AOL software running consistently in the background. That's what essentially AOL Dialer was. That's essentially what it was. Nowadays, most people either have fixed wireless internet, satellite internet, cable internet, and some mainly cable internet, DSL internet in some areas, or fiber internet in some areas. And most cell phones that are more modern nowadays offer mobile hotspot tethering as a way to get online if you're out somewhere, or if you live somewhere way out in the sticks where wireless internet works but cable internet doesn't work. Well, that's essentially the gist of it, but other than that, this is all I have to say. And I sadly do miss dial-up in some form, because it was just easy. Plug your telephone cord into your computer remote, into your modem on your computer, plug the telephone other end of the telephone cord into the wall jack, You hit sign on AOL MSN. You simply listen for the do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. You listen for it to dial the number, the dial tone to turn on, and then you hear it dial the number out in DTMF tones or pull styling, and then you just listen for it to connect, and you're on. But dial-up wasn't really perfect without its flaws. Dial-up was susceptible to being interrupted by an incoming phone call, or you couldn't really dial out to the internet when a phone line's in use, like a home phone. When I was a kid in 2005, 2004, like from 2002 to like 2005, I was like a kid back then. I couldn't really use dial-up till about 11:59 midnight, Friday night, Saturday nights. Mainly Friday and Saturday nights, I was allowed to use dial-up then, but I couldn't use it during Monday through Thursday because I had school nights to deal with, so I couldn't be on the computer during a school night. So I waited till Friday or Thursday to cut, or waited till Friday or Saturday rather, to cut the computer on it right around after I get home from school afterwards, and then plug in a telephone cable to the computer and wall jack, and then select sign on AOL MSN. And stay on the dial-up internet all night from like midnight till about 5 a.m. in the morning, because that time I could be on the internet as long as I want during that time frame and then sign off afterward. But I was excited to get cable broadband internet in 2005, ditching AOL and its dial-up service, even though I was aware that AOL had AOL broadband that supported AOL connections through DSL or cable, but still, it still worked with dial-up through AOL dial-up, but there was also AOL broadband support that supported TCP/IP connections to the AOL network versus the dial-up servers from an AOL side accepting incoming calls from a person's dial-up modem. This video has gone long enough for 22 minutes, and this is William Armstrong. Till next time, I'm William Armstrong.